Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our November CSER research seminar. My name's Hugh Price. I'm a philosopher, but I'm also academic director of CSER. And this evening, I'm very pleased to introduce a former colleague of mine from philosophy, Professor Jane Heal, who's very well known for her work in philosophy of language and philosophy of mind. And who's also distinguished, she was formerly a president of St. John's College. She's been a supporter of CSER almost from the beginning, for which all of us in CSER are extremely grateful. And it's a delight for me to welcome her here this evening to talk to us on pushing the limits. Jane, welcome.
Thank you very much, Hugh. Thank you, everybody, for coming this evening. Let me just say, these remarks have been put together very hastily when Sean asked me earlier this term to contribute to this series. I'm very glad to have the chance of sharing these with you, very sketchy and broad brush though they be, and I look forward to hearing your thoughts in discussion at the end. So, what is CSER doing? Trying to increase the human capacity to anticipate and deal with future bad contingencies of a particular kind, those produced by the unintended consequences of our own exploitation of technologies that we've invented. So some of the questions are, can we detect and characterize and grasp the nature of the potential outcomes of what we're doing? Can we see how to mitigate them? How to change our behavior to avoid the bad consequences? Can we persuade relevant agents, including ourselves, to take the relevant mitigatory action? So that sounds like one theoretical question. What's going to happen? One theoretico-practical one, one might say. What are the ways of mitigating? And third, one which is, so to speak, practical, which is, can we, shall we, do this thing to mitigate the risk? But they link, I think, perhaps, in that the motivating action on identified options may connect with how we characterize the outcomes of what we're doing. So that's one thought that I'll say a little, tiny little bit more about later. So what resources do we bring to dealing with these enormous challenges which CSER is trying to grapple with? What are we human beings like in our capacity for thought and action? That's something of which it might conceivably be useful to have an overview, because it might have some relevance to how one sets about dealing with CSER's challenges. But let me say, frankly, I'm not saying that it will be useful. I have a couple of observations to make at the end about this, teeny-weeny ones. But really, I'm pursuing the question, what are we like and what resources do we have here, just because it's an interesting question in its own right. It's over to you as to whether the picture to be sketched is accurate and as to its implications, if any. So where am I coming from, let me just make this a bit clearer, in setting about putting these thoughts together? Well, philosophy is, of course, in the business of trying to say in a general way what us human beings are like, what we ought to be like. And as a philosopher, I've got some knowledge of what philosophers have said about this in philosophy of mind, moral psychology, ethics, so forth. And I've some acquaintance with attempts to get at or even to formalize how we ought to think and decide under conditions of both certainty and uncertainty, as it were, logic, Bayesianism, games theory, and da-da-da. But I'm not seriously knowledgeable in these four formal areas, so there's not going to be much of that this evening. These philosophical discussions are by and large a priori, at least done in the armchair, on the basis of so-called common sense. But we are liable to find oversimplified accounts of ourselves easy and attractive, congenial and culturally acceptable, when doing things a priori or in the armchair. So empirical evidence from intellectual history, also from the perspectives opened up by various branches of the sciences, biological and human, such as the theory of evolution and psychology in its many versions, developmental, social, and so forth, archaeology, anthropology, etc. All of these things seem to me very important as well in building up a picture of what we human beings are like. and I'm not seriously knowledgeable in any of these fields either. No way am I claiming that, but I've sort of dabbled. Of the fields in which CSER is interested, I've been concerned with climate change for a number of years and have tried to get some grip on the science and the policy and the psychology of that. That's another thing which is, as you'll see shortly, very much coming into the mix here. But with other CSER areas, sort of nano and bio and AI and so forth, are not anything about which I would claim to know very much. So here's the structure of what's coming up in the light of what resources I can muster, as it were, to address these issues. I'm going to take climate change as an example of an existential challenge that we're trying to grapple with and with which we have had difficulties. So I'll reflect on our resources, what that case suggests about the nature, the origin of some of the difficulties that we face. And I'll say a tiny bit at the end about where the idea is generalised to the other, one other CSER area at least. All that will be highly speculative. And then it's over to you. Right, so the challenge of climate change as one existential challenge. Here's a question to start with. Why are we having so much difficulty dealing with it? My answer, we're at our limits when we think about it, intellectually and also, very importantly, emotionally, ethically, politically, we're at our limits. Hence, of course, the title of this talk, we're pushing up against our limits in dealing with these challenges. And it's not that we wholly lack resources for thinking about it. Things are not hopeless in that way, not at all. We have resources for thinking and acting about it, but there's a good deal of conflict, stress, confusion, difference of views, and so on. And one central thing which we differ about, and from which much else follows, is the priority which we give to the matter, as individuals or institutions or governments. And by giving something priority, I mean devoting resources to it. Time, energy, intellectual power, wealth, emotional strength, personal influence, so on. So, just an example here. Suppose a person to have received the unpleasant news that a loved one has or may have some progressive and nasty illness. So they've received the news that there is or may be in train in the loved one a process which will lead to bad things unless steps are taken to arrest it. When that news is received, it is likely that the person will make the loved one's illness, or possible illness, a priority. And now, depending on circumstances, this will come out in various ways. Getting the treatment, really be going about vigorously getting the treatment, or if there isn't one known, vigorously researching what a possible treatment might be, or if it's uncertain whether the illness is there or not, making real serious efforts to find out whether it is or not, and so forth and so on. That's what I mean by giving it priority. It's got an emotional, you understand what I mean. It matters to one, and one acts on it. Okay, now with climate change, we have the possibility, indeed, I suspect, the certainty, something pretty analogous in the following sense, that there is in train in the Earth, its atmosphere, oceans, biosphere, etc., a process driven by human activity, emitting carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases, which, if not arrested, will result in the rise in average global temperature within invisible lifetimes, that's our children and grandchildren's lifetimes, 4 or 5 degrees centigrade or more, with consequences for other elements of the climate and biosphere, and hence large bad effects on all of the following: life in the seas, diversity of life in the seas and forests, sea levels, droughts, floods, food availability, famine, refugee flows, disease, war, political stability, education, civil order, good governance, etc., etc., all around the world, with effects here, right here, of course. And in the light of recent events in refugees in Europe and people being blown up and so forth and so on, I guess I don't need to elaborate on the dangers for right here. And for some people, dealing with this is a priority. They spend their resources on it, and that's very encouraging. I mean, it shows that it's possible to get engaged and to spend one's resources on this, and many people do. But other people give it priority in the radically opposite sense. by trying to confute it, to tell us that it isn't really happening and we don't need to bother about it and so forth and so on. Deniers, skeptics of various kinds. But very interestingly, there are plenty of people who don't give it high priority in either of these ways. It doesn't much affect what they think or do as individuals or in their professional capacities. It's the existence of this second group and very notably this third group which presents a difficulty for the world, so to speak, getting to grips with climate change. So, but why are there these differences in the priority that various different individuals and groups have given to the issue? Well, it's something to do, plainly it's something to do with how we think and feel. It's something to do with how our minds work. So much is obvious, but how do our minds work to govern what we give priority to? That's the issue. So, the backstory. So now we come to one page of the one-page summary of the whole of evolutionary and cultural history. Wow, we're going to go fast here. But we need to get the backstory of where we've come from to situate ourselves as we are now. So I allege, anyhow. So we've evolved over 3.5 billion years or so from unicellular organisms. And these unicellular organisms were, and some of their current descendants are, capable of only very limited registering of and responsiveness to what's around them. They can nourish themselves by engulfing nutrients, and they can excrete what's not needed. They can, some of them, withdraw from what's harmful, and so forth. So teeny-weeny little bits, teeny-weeny little things. But there's no registering at all of what's at a distance from them in space and time. As evolution moves on, some of them give rise to multicellular organisms. They somehow succeed in clumping together, which turn into animals. They have specialized kinds of cells, which are organized into tissues, limbs, sense organs, and so forth, capable of awareness and action on what is around them at a distance in both space and time. Now, how this worked, how all that happened in detail, obscure and fascinating. But in broad terms, it seems evident that creatures have evolved so that what goes on at their surfaces gets processed and transformed into continuing patterns of activity inside them. So they get sense of eyes, ears, touch, and so on, gets processed into complicated things in the brain and the nervous system. And in yet more complicated animals, some of the later arriving information, what it feeds in the interior, interacts in interesting ways with what's already there to produce yet more complexly nuanced ensembles of sensitivity and responsiveness to the environment. And at its most complex, or altogether, as it were, these processes amount to the creature investigating and representing its world, becoming aware of more and more kinds of thing, stuff, etc., in the world around it. And some of these animals which evolved were social animals, including our ancestors. And the kinds of things of which these animals were aware and could respond to included each other, but represented not as merely as potential predator or prey, but represented as rival, partner, offspring, and so forth. So now about 40,000 years ago or so, creatures pretty like us begin to be apparent in the archaeological record. That is to say, a kind of primate appears, which is not only social, but naturally cultural. That's capable of passing on acquired skills and building on what has been acquired. So we find increasingly elaborated and elegant hand axes. And hand axes go back a long, long way beforehand, but they don't change much. And suddenly they start sort of changing, getting more elegant, structured, you know, a few tens of thousands of years ago. And then we find early artifacts in bone, and then we've got woven fibers into fabrics, baskets, and so baked clay, metallurgy, settled villages, domestication of animals, planting of crops, da-da-da, and soon, so no, about 10,000 years before the Christian era here, we've got named and recognisable cultures and states, China, Babylon, Egypt, Greece, and we've cities, statues, temples, writing, and at this point we're into history, real named individuals, prophets, poets, queens, festivals, discoveries, da-da-da. Skipping on with extreme rapidity, in the 16th and 17th century, we, or at least some among us, began to get a sense of the solar system, its size and structure, and began to get a grip on recognizable physics, chemistry, physiology, etc. And in the late 18th century, we get deep space coming into our awareness with Herschel and the refracting telescope reaching out to the galaxies and the extraordinary depths of space. But that, we didn't know about that till the late 18th century. And in the 18th and 19th centuries, we begin to get some real grip on deep time with geology, the theory of evolution, get a serious grip on this. And at that point, we are also in a position to begin to do serious intellectual history. So we begin to do that, and linguistics, anthropology, and the like come on the scene. Maths has been moving on amazingly, accelerating from the ancient world on, but whoosh, it goes in the 19th and 20th century. And we get into modern logic, computing, and all of that means. Also, of course, technology and manufacturing have been moving with increasing speed. I mean, from the ancient world, but very much faster from the Industrial Revolution. Now we have the modern state, Weberian bureaucracy, capitalism, Marxism, world wars, internet, Arab Spring, ISIS, whoosh! And here we are. And still, of course, on it goes. Billions and billions of us, each doing his, her thing. On it goes. Well, now, some comments on all of this. First thing, there has been conceptual change throughout all the last few thousands of years. The shape of our cultural life is changing, developing new words, new skills, new ways of thinking, new practices, new options for action. There's no one fixed language, vocabulary, which demarcates the possibilities that humans are aware of. What they can think, what they can do, da-da-da, no fixed vocabulary. It's always changing. So we have new science as we probe out into the natural world, but we also have new religion, technology, law, politics, and so forth. And hence, we have new concepts for ways of human living which we have invented. Example, at some point, looking back to the past, tens of thousands of years ago, we have fine men and women living in small nomadic groups, hunter-gatherer societies and so on. Fast forward a few thousand years, and their descendants, living in roughly the same parts of the world, are living in cities, and they have words for citizen, law court, etc., which their ancestors did not have, and they have the institutions, the practices, and so forth, which go with that. So in a good number of these new concepts that came on the scene then and are coming on new, still coming on the scene now, have to do with institutions which we've developed in which we are aware of and responsive to things which are, how can I put it, larger rather than smaller. Our city, not just our family. Long-term stability of social relations rather than short-term revenge on one who has wronged us. So we've somehow succeeded in building, as it were, larger and larger cooperative enterprises as we've moved forward through history. And we've developed vocabulary for them and ways of dealing with them. So more of that, a little more of that later. So that's one comment on the cultural history part of this, as you might like. A second very general comment on this, thought aroused by this, for some part of this story, the very last few thousand years, there have been creatures who live their lives consciously, And at some point, there were these unicellular creatures, and they weren't doing much that was conscious. And then, zoom, 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 animals, cultural history, on it goes, da-da-da-da-da. And then somehow or the other, at this point, there are creatures who are living consciously. What do I mean by that? That they're creatures who are aware of what is happening to them. They're feeling hungry, being pushed, falling into the river, or whatever. And they're aware of what they're doing, daydreaming, walking, drinking, quarrelling, and so on, at the time when those things are going on. So they know how things are with them, in some respects, at least. They know what they're up to. An important aspect of this conscious-mindedness is supplied by memory, both for general facts about the world and so forth, but also for particular dated events in one's own life and so on. And so we have creatures who can string together a narrative about how things have gone for them or how things have gone for us more broadly. So these creatures are in a position to reflect on their lives and to tell stories about it and make plans and so forth. So now, when did this conscious living emerge? By what stages? Well, surely we are such creatures, and it goes back at least a good few thousands of years, because we've got the writings and the poems and the buildings of the people of a good few thousand years ago, and plainly they are us, living their conscious lives. But before that, 40,000, 100,000? What good questions. I've got no answers to them. Has it got something to do with language? What's it got to do with? That's not the subject of this talk. But thinking about the conscious-mindedness, which we now plainly have, it's the goings-on there which very much preoccupy us. This is us living our lives. That's our mindedness. That's in the foreground of our attention, the focus of interest, what we're busy about all the time. And part of this, just one part, one little strand of this conscious living of our lives, we sometimes deliberate explicitly about what is the case, what to do. You know, we have our political discussions and so forth and so on. We have our seminars, like here and now. This is us doing some of our conscious living, doing some deliberating. That's what's going on now. And what we were talking about before, in climate change, when I was remarking on the different priorities that different people give to it, I was remarking on something about the structure of this conscious-mindedness, the different roles that the awareness of the possibility of climate change has in different people's conscious deliberations. So what we'd like to know is what gives something a role, and indeed a role where it can pull levers and so on, in people's conscious-mindedness. And all of us thinking about these things are evolved animals. So whatever goes for explicit thinking in involved animals goes for our explicit thinking about climate change and for thinking about the other CSER questions as well. So let's think more about explicit thinking and its role in our lives. So to be the setting in which our conscious deliberations and seminars and political discussions and all that sort of thing operates. So let's think about the overall structure of the mindedness of these creatures whose evolution I've just sketched so extremely rapidly. So something very broadly Aristotelian, it seems to me, is a good start here. What we are is matter organized more and more intricately so as to be able to exhibit increasingly elegant and interesting capacities. Each capacity building on, incorporating, extending what goes before, opening up new possibilities. So I'm not offering a kind of biological determinism here, but more an emergentism, if there's anybody wants a label for this metaphysical picture. So roughly, vegetable, animal, and then social, cultural, each building on and developing the other. So, a little bit more detail, there's the what's going on in us, each of us right now, is an ongoing flow of organic, say vegetable life, but organic life at the cellular level, We're an enormous number of cells, and each of our cells is doing its kind of cell-y thing, nourishing itself, duplicating itself, clinging together with the other ones, twisting, da-di-da-di-da-di-da, all according to its own, the chemical and electrical and so forth energies in it. And then the assemblages of these cells, right in us, right here and now, are constituting bones, organs, muscles, limbs, etc. The elements of an animal functionally defined. And in virtue of being these kinds of creatures with these kinds of organs, elements, and so forth, we exhibit reflexes, we feel hunger and thirst, heat and cold, we're subject to a diurnal rhythm of sleeping and waking. We can focus our eyes, we can walk, grasp, move, keep ourselves upright, all these kinds of things. And then digest, feel sleepy, all that kind of stuff. And then on top of that, I don't mean ontologically separate, but I mean incorporating that as its material, we have the ongoing flow of culturally influenced activity, which is where we're living our life, part of which is us living our conscious lives. So it calls on these things, and so to speak, shapes and enriches them. So we go to sleep and emerge from sleep, which is something we do as animals, but we do it in culturally shaped ways, with all their meanings and significance. I mean, beds, bedding, bathrooms, teeth, toothbrushes, all this kind of stuff. And of course, we eat and drink, as any animal must, but we do it in the culturally shaped ways. Breakfast cereals, tables, bowls, spoons, etc. And we have our feasts and our parties and so on. And we keep warm, but we do it by dressing. We put on our jackets, we do up our buttons, and so forth, and so on. So in all of this, this living of our lives, well, I'm aware of doing up my buttons if I do that in the morning, or putting my pullover on over my head, and so on. In all of this, an enormous amount of acquired skill with artifacts, dealing with artifacts, buttons, spoons, and pullovers, and so on. An enormous amount of habit and custom. An enormous amount of habit and custom as to when those skills are exercised and on what and with whom, because of course quite a lot of this is about our relations with other people. So it's habit, custom, which largely dictates the shape of our days and the activities which fill those days. You rise, you breakfast, you go to work, you talk to your colleagues, you do a bit of shopping, you go home, you have dinner, blah, blah, blah. That's what you do, because that's how we live. And in carrying out this flow of activities, which habit lays down, we exercise our skills at relevant points, which are made salient to us by the habits of noticing, which we've been trained into. So now let's put the question brutally, let's put the absolutely brutal question, what role is there for the deliberations of the conscious mind, our rational selves, and da-da-da, in determining what we do? An answer, not as much as some pictures suggest. I mean, the power of the conscious mind is quite severely circumscribed. The thoughts and the conclusions arrived at there will only lead to action given the relevant, appropriate setting, the substructure of further thoughts, habits, feelings, skills, the whole cultural setting which makes a thought able to animate the person in whom it occurs. The conscious mind, our deliberated thinking, does not control the doings of what would otherwise be, sort of wholly control the doings of what would otherwise be a mere inert, lumpish, physical thing. So the mind, the body, and the one animates the other, and the mind is the wholly conscious deliberations, supposedly done rationally or whatever, which animates the lumpish body. That's not the right picture of the kind of creatures we are. Rather, the conscious mind, as it were, tweaks or directs various of the ongoing occurrence, more habitual, automatic processes, which are proceeding, so to speak, under their own impetus, under their own energies, capable of tweaking and directing. I'll put this thing on this morning rather than that thing. That thing looks a bit dirty. I'll have a nice clean da-da-da this morning, and so on. It can tweak and direct, but only given appropriate levers and so on to pull. So now, deliberated thought, conscious reflection in seminars and da-da-da, people realizing, writing and so on, this is capable of getting great things done. I'm not wanting to say it's impotent. It's capable of getting great things done in the right circumstances. So we human beings are capable of caring about more than the short term and our own interest. Indeed, we want meaning in our lives. We want to be part of some big cause and to contribute to something worthwhile and to know that there's value in what we do because we're part of something bigger than ourselves, which has meaning and goes on beyond us and so on. Most of us want to live a life of that kind. But the deliberated grip on these big causes, the meanings and so on, and the habits and feelings and concepts which go with caring about them, they need installing in us by education, by ritual, practice, by immersion in a way of living where caring about these big causes is going on around us and where there are recognized patterns of recognition of expressing that care, where recognized ways of people being honored for doing their bit of caring for the bigger thing and so on. I'm going back to the concept of my city, which I had earlier, and all that goes with the concept of a city. I mean, if I'm living the kind of life where I have that concept and where it's installed in me by my education and is shared by those around me, then great things can happen. For example, if my city is under threat from drought, I may, with others, put in much labor, vast labor, building an elegant aqueduct. But for somebody's vision of the aqueduct, that is the conscious thought of some deliberators, gosh, there's a drought, we could solve that drought by having an aqueduct. For the thoughts of those people who are aware of the drought and the possibility of the aqueduct to have any force in among the other people in the community around them, in order for them to, so to speak, turn into a real aqueduct, we need the social setting where doing good things for my city is a recognized and familiar and respected kind of prioritizing of one's efforts. The city is in danger. We must all rally. If that's a familiar thought for us as we live in our city, then we're capable of rallying to build the aqueduct or whatever may need doing. So, thoughts about deliberated thoughts, realizations of what the world is like and what we need to do to avoid this and so forth and so on, all that can produce great results, but it needs the right setting to do it. That's one consequence of the story that I've been telling about the nature of the conscious mind and how it sits on top of all these other capacities of human beings. But another corollary of that story that I was telling about our evolution, the conscious mind and so forth, is that the things that we focus on consciously in our conscious mindedness, what we're aware of as possible objects of our choice, and the things that we consciously know ourselves to be pursuing, these things are by no means guaranteed to exhaust what we need, what provides a rich and satisfactory life for us. Much of what we need, what provides a rich and satisfactory life, is in fact just supplied to us. I mean, bodies with digestions which work and limbs, etc., and the gravity to hold us onto the surface of the earth and the sun and the rain and the plants and the oceans, currents, clouds, other people, our culture, and so on. by and large, in our deliberative lives, we take the existence of all this stuff and its continuance totally for granted. That's not what I aim to produce. It's just the background against which I build my career. I get this nice house. I get myself a lovely new dress, da-da-da. And those conscious aims just take this background of the continuance of the what matters, the substructure, supplies the possibility of what matters to us, just for granted. So taking responsibility for the large-scale features of our environment, that is a very, very new idea for us. Very, very new. And this is why I think we're at our limits in grasping what is going on with climate change. We're at our limits in finding ways to envisage it or to feel about it, and so to act on it. So I'll just say a bit more about that thought. So understanding the world as a whole in any detail is an achievement of the last three or four centuries only. Unbelievably recent in evolutionary history. And it's happened via the explicit complex intellectual constructs of the sciences, physics, astronomy, chemistry, biology, and so forth and so on, and the historical dimensions in cosmology and the theory of evolution and so on. And so in these last four centuries where these sciences have been elaborated, the cultural tools and constructs have become amazingly more elaborate, but our grip on them, and speaking for myself here, is tenuous and partial. And the grip is sort of distributed, think of a community, it's distributed among many, many different human beings. And when we're thinking about climate change, we're thinking about extraordinary number of interdependent things, the oceans and the currents in them, the sea level and the temperatures, the dissolved CO2 and so forth. And we think about the sky, cloud, wind, rains, particulates and so forth, the land surfaces, the forests, deserts, savannas, rivers, glaciers, and the life forms which inhabit them, and all these things. And we've got to think about them all with their interactions with each other, developing across time, what, the next 10 years, next 20 years, 50 years, 100 years. And we've got to put probabilities on various of the paths. I mean, it's just, just staggering what it is we've got to try and get a grip on what's happening. So that's as it were the first question. Why are we having difficulty? We had three questions right at the beginning. What's actually happening? What's ways of mitigating it? Can we do it? Right, okay, so what's actually happening? Unbelievably complicated, grasped, tenuous, complex, mediated by scientific concepts most of us don't understand, blah, blah, blah. So understanding it's a problem. What can we do about it? Thinking up the strategies for acting. Well, this is difficult too. So many actors, so many timescales, so many clashing interests. Should it go bottom up, top down, world government, different political systems, carbon trading schemes, regulation, new technologies? Oh. All very complicated. But we might be able to overcome those difficulties if the issue were given priority. If pretty well all relevant agents, individuals, governments, firms, etc., were agreed, well, something's got to be done about this, then we could get stuck in to try to agree something. But in fact, it doesn't get priority. So we're not all stuck in. We're not all agreed. Something's got to be done about this. Oh, well, somebody else will solve it. Think about it next year. Just drifts away for most of us. So why does it just drift away? Well, I think it's something which, here's my suggestion, it circles back to our first issue, that is the first question, what is it that's actually going on? Grasping what it is that we're doing, finding some way to characterize it and feel about it is a very difficult, I think. We're only, I think, beginning to have a sort of appropriate institutions of vocabulary or actions to go with giving it priority or feeling strongly about it. So to put it, my city, my country, Yes, these are familiar concepts, and the whole raft of institutions and actions and feelings and habits and so on which they arouse, there they lie to hand. I must rally to the defense of my city. We all know what my country, whatever. That's a familiar thought. My biosphere? What's that? You know, where are the institutions? Where is it patriotism I feel towards it? Is it love? I mean, what is it, my biosphere? You know, how do I, in my city, there's the city council and there's the elections and da-da-da. My biosphere? Where's the leave? Where's the actions, the institutions, the, what to do about it, you know? I mean, it's not that we've got absolutely nothing to say on these fronts, but we are struggling to build, the vocabulary, the institutions, the vision, the levers which will make these words, like sea levels will rise and, you know, temperatures will rise and lots more storms and da-da-da-da-da and so on. We're trying to build the levers of habit and institution and action and so on that will get those ding, 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 little thoughts and so on to reach down into the bits of us where the actions happen, to connect with the cogs and the driving wheels and the so on, which are what are just pushing us forward in our everyday living of our lives. Our ambitions, our careers, and making money for our firm or whatever it is that we're doing. And we're getting there in constructing the, I don't give up hope. I absolutely do not give up hope in constructing it. But I think one reason people don't give the issue priority is that they just don't know how to. It's just very, very difficult. I think it's frightening to think about it. And to think about it and give it priority requires diverting resources from where they're going at the moment in a way which is satisfactory and familiar to people who are building their successful careers, making lots of money selling coal or whatever it is they're doing. I mean, diverting resources is difficult. I mean, looking at the normative of what we're doing is seriously difficult. Not at all surprising that people look away, drift away. So that's my sketch of why we're having trouble dealing with climate change. So to speak, where the structure of the mind is not quite answering to the situation that we're only partly getting to grips with. That's my story about that. So much for climate change. Extremely, extremely briefly now. It seems to me there may be similar issues with at least one other CSER of topic, which is AI. Just because it may be coming to be embedded in our lives, in our everyday lives, as much embedded as the use of fossil fuel is. It comes to infect, that's the wrong word, to ramify through more and more of what we do, get embedded in how food is supplied to supermarkets, or how sewage farms are run, or how the energy system works, or how financial markets are run, or da-da-da. I mean, it's all, there it is, all over the place, lots of it doing this, that, and the other. Some of the thoughts, CSER, thoughts are about what is that embedding doing to us, making us very fragile, some of this making us very vulnerable to disruption at some points. But will we be willing to hear that message? Will we be willing to act on it? Mm-mm-mm. Perhaps not, for the same reasons as for climate change, viz. Because lots of powerful interests are profiting from it, and it's very convenient for us, and much, much easier to look away, and so on and so on. So, and perhaps it'll be the same way with nano and bio. I don't know. That seems to me, perhaps they raise other issues. I don't know. Interesting, eh? Oh. So, just very finally and concludingly, very general thoughts. What do we do? I mean, are there any morals here, so to speak, about how we ought to go at thinking about these, trying to tackle these issues? I think we just need to acknowledge the difficulties, the challenges to, so to speak, the business as usual, just onrushing of life. We need to acknowledge that becoming aware of the vulnerability of something which is taken for granted is very difficult, and to look away from business as usual and one's immersion in it and how comfortable and safe it feels, and to realise that in the very safe, comfortable things one is doing, one may, those very safe things may be undermining one. Gosh, that's difficult. We just need to acknowledge that it's difficult. So that's one thought. And just going on at people about the facts, that doesn't help. You've got to tackle these other things about helping us to understand what it is that we're really doing and to feel more at home with it. But in trying to address the challenges, I think we need new concepts. I suppose that's one of the things I was saying, new concepts, new tools, new institutions. So we need not just sort of abstract thoughts about probabilities, though they're doubtless an important part of the mix, but we need new institutions, new actions. And we should be ambitious in thinking about these things, but we should also be seriously realistic about how finite we are. I think that's what I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jane, for that fascinating and extremely thought-provoking talk. We've now got a little over half an hour for Q&A. We don't have a roving microphone that we've had at some of the previous sessions, so I want to ask people to speak up, please, so that, if possible, the video will pick up the question as well as Jane's answer. So I'm going to throw it open to you now. If you'd like to ask a question, please raise your hand, and I'll try and keep a rough cue. Apologies if I miss somebody at some point. Yes.
So if I can bring it to existential risks, because that's what you're trying to tackle. And I'm just thinking aloud. If you imagine there's two dominant species in Britain, one is the wolf and the other is the human, and the wolves aren't realizing that the humans are slowly eliminating them, and if they could get to the position that that they realise, then they would perhaps, that their mind or consciousness could get together and eliminate the humans first.
Yes.
Then the wolves would rule here. And so, coming back, so the existential threat is the human being to the wolf, but he doesn't quite perceive it. He's looking at something else, he's looking at how many sheep it can get or whatever, or where it can hide. And perhaps with some of the existential risks that we're dealing with in CSER, take AI, perhaps we're addressing the wrong problem. Perhaps we're thinking that the computers and the robots are going to threaten our existence, which is not that probable in the near future. Mm-hmm. What may be the problem is the way we gather data, and the way we use data, and the way we interpret data, and the way we feed these data into the AI systems that we're developing. In other words, we have got an existential risk related to data, but we think it's about AI.
I'm not knowledgeable enough to comment directly on that, but it seems to me plausible. But if, we're the wolves as well as the humans. I mean, we're the existential. We are posing. You're offering me the choice. Is it the data or is it the machines, as it were, roughly speaking? But I'm inclined to say neither of them. It's us, because we're the ones who are insisting on collecting the data or analysing it or whatever. We're the ones who are running the machine. I don't know whether that addresses your. But
yes, of course. It's our fault. But they're not looking properly at the issue.
I think that may well be true. I don't know enough about the AI and the data.
Yes,
It'd be a pleasure to comment knowledgeably on that.
Person in the middle there, yes.
I liked your story about how building better institutions as a society might help us to mean that actually in the future people will go and take the steps necessary to defend against these things. And if the lack of institutions, because we just haven't had long enough perhaps to develop them yet to protect things at a global scale, that is hurting us. Do you have any thoughts on what the steps along the route to developing these institutions are? Is it about showing people that there are things that can be done, or is it about just building this consciousness and making people identify more with the global scale?
I think they've got to go hand in hand. I mean, I suppose that was another element. So since I threw these thoughts together so rapidly, I haven't really thought them through, but I mean, what you ask prompts me to say that I suspect they go hand in hand. So, as well, seeing something as really valuable and as to be protected seems to me to go together. It's something you can't really fully do until you see how to do it. So just saying, it's very valuable, and so sort of doesn't get one anywhere. So, I mean, I'm very keen on building, at least beginning to piece together kinds of action that people can do. I mean, at the very least, you can say to every individual here, you've got a carbon footprint, you could cut it, mate. You know, I mean, the thought of saying, well, they must do something about it, you know. They should build some institutions on, we should build an institution. Yeah. So we should get together, we should try and think what supports us, and so on. So we should do what we can. I mean, look what's out there. There's quite a lot good that's going on already. And so don't just, oh dear me, it's all so difficult and so on. Get out there and do it. Yeah.
Okay, I'm building up quite a queue here.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, yes, there.
Jimmy, you raised some very interesting problems for us to think about. I wonder if I could get your thoughts on two related issues. The first, which I find fascinating, is that climate change is an extremely difficult area, nonlinear feedbacks and understanding of all the areas that you mentioned. Most, but not all scientists believe that climate change is a problem, and yet there are a huge number of people in the streets, a huge number of politicians who couldn't hope to understand the details,
yes,
skeptical about, who don't believe it.
Yes.
I mean, isn't this interesting that a whole group who can't evaluate the arguments for themselves,
yes,
disagree with the,
yes,
few people who were at?
Yes. Yes.
And the second point I wanted to raise,
yes,
which has sort of been raised by you and some of the question is this is really amongst the first, if not the actual first, global problem that we've had to face. And that's really the problem. You can say, well, we shouldn't eat meat, and this ban was not to eat meat, that would make it slightly better. But it would be inconsequentially better. Really nothing that Britain itself can do, other than have influence on China and India, etc. But nothing Britain itself can do is going to change the output of carbon dioxide. And another aspect which I can speak about quantitatively is Australia, where only 1% of the carbon dioxide put into the atmosphere is put in over Australia. So if Australia all stopped burning coal and carbon dioxide, that would make any difference. But 4.5% of the amount of carbon dioxide that's put into the atmosphere originates from Australia. It's Australian coal. That also is
extremely
small,
yeah,
that if that was stopped, that would not make much difference,
yeah,
except to the economy of Australia. The difference between 4.5 and 1 is a huge amount for financial aspects of Australia's life.
4.5 what?
4.5% of the amount of 37 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide is put in due to the carbon dioxide that started in the form of Australia.
So two very interesting points there. About why are people who aren't really knowledgeable about this think that there's some doubt here and deny and so on. Well, I'm so enormously complicated and I don't really have a detailed answer to that, but I mean, one very important element of it is, my estimation, one, that it's actually horrible to look at, so it's so much easier not to face up to it, so you grabble on to any little little excuse for not doing so, and the media are not helpful and so forth and so on. But it seems to me also there's a sort of at some level there's a kind of bad faith or sort of unease going on here. I think the mind is not a big stable system. You either believe it or you don't believe it and so on. It's a question of how deeply you engage with it or how much courage you've got to engage with it. And the shape of a lot of stuff that goes on under the denialist frame is this. You somebody alleges absolutely awful things will happen unless we stop emitting carbon dioxide and so on. That's the proposition P, and they say it very, very emphatically. And they're taken to be saying, it's certainly P, it's absolutely certain that P. And along comes your denier and says, well, it isn't absolutely certain that P. And you find some little, of course, the more detailed you get into the predictions of what's going to happen, the less certainty you've got. So lots of grounds for saying it's not certain that P. And then that's taken to be equivalent to it's probable not P. I mean, so having said that, pointed out that it's not certain, that emotionally you flip over to thinking that it's probable that it's not going to happen, and you turn your mind away from it. And it's just very psychologically easy to do that. Especially when it's not, so if you're pointing, you're playing Russian roulette and you've got a revolver with six chambers, not the one sixth the other way around, it's five and six and so on. And if I take it and I point it at Hugh's head, of course I would never do, and so on. But they say something awful will happen if you pull the trigger, and I say, well, it's not certain something will happen, there's one chance in six and five. And so on, one would think that was absurd. And Hugh and Olga and so on would not be pleased with my pulling the trigger. You know, I got £1 million for doing it on the grounds that it wasn't certain that he were doing some no good. But in effect, that's the kind of. And we don't make that move with the familiar risks, like guns going off and so on. But we do it with the unfamiliar risks because we haven't got the tools to thinking. I mean, I'm back to my familiar story here. Anyhow, that's the best I can offer on that. So you said something very interesting about what we can do in Britain and what we can affect on Australia and so on and so on. Well, so imagine that you're back at the time when the concept of the city isn't so, as it were, isn't so well entrenched. So we're back in. Some people have got a vision of a rich cooperative form of life where there's lots of good things that are going to happen if we can live together peaceably, quite large numbers of us, and specialise our labour and talk and have justice systems. So people have got a vision of a wonderful sort of cooperative future, but the city isn't stably established or grounded in people's feelings and so on. And somebody is saying sort of rather grumpily, well, I'm not going to help to build the walls, or I won't come to your meeting about how to adjudicate quarrels and so on. I've got my own land to till and blah, blah, blah. And refuses to take a part in the building of the thing. Of course, in a way, he or she, they do right, because by the lights of the interests, the good things that they've envisaged in their comparatively limited life, building the city will put a cost on it, and so on. But I mean, from our point of view, where the buildings of the cities and the buildings of great universities and so on have enabled us to, you know, put a rocket on a comet out there. I mean, think of the complexity of the enterprise that results in putting a rocket out on a comet so on. I mean, the education systems and the universities and the stable governments and the different technologies and the cooperation of all the people, the team, and shooting it up. It's just wonderful. So you couldn't have that unless there were lots and lots of people living delicately coordinated lives and respecting each other, all contributing their own richness to the thing. And you say, well, I won't do it. I'm just going to stay on my farm, da-da-da-da-da. You've missed it, mate. And okay, so, I mean, if people want to miss it, they want to miss it. But personally, I am on board for saving the globe. Are you? It's up to you.
Nick, now, and I saw a whole lot more hands went up. Please, those people who just put hands up, keep them up, and I'll add you to the queue. But Nick, you go ahead.
I know what you said, but I kind of like the way in which you framed it in terms of limits on human concepts or human thinking. Snaps of the arguments that you've used in a lot of other fields, okay, we can't expect human beings ever to understand this problem. It says, for example, about understanding the nature of consciousness. And they say, well, Martin Rees has said, you know, we can't expect a chimpanzee to understand quantum physics, and therefore, why should we expect to understand these things which are beyond us? And one answer to that is, well, you couldn't expect Plato to understand quantum physics either. But it's human scaffold their reasoning and their concepts, and just the way as you were saying. I mean, we develop a culture which, slowly by slowly, gives us new ways of thinking about things, which are almost infinite, I would say, in the end. There's no biological constraint on that. And I wonder why you insist on telling biological stories if it was going to place some limits on kind of ideas people have. I think not only can we think about these very big issues, but that we do. And that you look at the culture around us, the culture of horror movies, the culture of children's nightmare stories, religious beliefs about end time, and so on. Our culture, right across the globe in different ways, is actually riddled with disaster stories about what's coming down the line. And sometimes, at least if we don't do the right things ourselves to stop it, like, you know, praying for the rain god or sacrificing a lamb or whatever it may be, it's there already. But it's certainly true that, I mean, if we can think about these things, we don't a lot of the time. And you made that point when you talked about denial, which I'm sure is a very crucial issue to bring up. And obviously, you're aware of that, and you don't have much more to say about that. But apart from denial, I want to ask more further about your institutions, which we need to change or we need to invent, which will give us these new ways of thinking. I don't think they're going to be institutions of that kind that are going to, you know, give us a new perspective on life and the future. I think we've got this already. I think it's quite clear they're political institutions, and we use the same word for them. What's going to solve the problem of anything is going to be politics. As Herbert was pointing out, none of us is ever likely to have any influence on the outcome of climate change or a good many other issues like nuclear weapons and so on. But political institutions which we support may be able to. But maybe they won't be able to, and so it may actually be necessary to have a world culture in which new kinds of political institutions, which would be anathema to Democrats, for example, will have to be in place. Autocratic, quick acting, non consulting oligarchies of some sort, which will take control and do what we're not doing already. It's actually more likely than not that some country like China, which is actually already more involved in the crime of climate change, is going to provide the solution to it because it is able to take political steps which Britain or Australia can't, and particularly which we individuals can't.
What a lot then, what's there? I'm not sure that I disagree. I'm not a biological determinist. I would say biology. We'll never understand consciousness, and so I mean, if I sounded as though I was saying that, I should withdraw. I think we build things slowly. Things evolve and develop slowly. Impetus. I think it's difficult to make as well leaps into new concepts and so on. And as to issues about new institutions and so on. I think those debates need to be had. I mean, for my own part, I would rather give
I would rather get out there and give it a go, as I was saying to one of the earlier questions, than say, oh, we can't do anything, some dictator will have to step in. And I find that a sort of depressing view, right? So I put my own part is I'd rather give it a bit more welly in the democratic direction. But who knows? Who knows? I mean, things are difficult. I mean, no way am I denying it.
The person next to Sean, I guess.
Thank you. Just thinking back to this sort of line of reasoning around why thinking, although we're starting to get there with thinking, but it doesn't turn into action. Mm-hmm. And the fact that this thinking is sort of, and even if you do get from thinking to feeling quite strongly about it, that it's still mediated before it gets to action by this cultural settings, habits, these levers.
Mm-hmm.
So sort of picking up from there, how do we, and that might include CSER, so I guess it's kind of a question to the room, how do we build or create or foster those cultural patterns that you mentioned, whereby prioritizing action on climate is reflected and recognized? So I think that's kind of a facilitative role, right, that we can play building that environment where those things do develop. I don't think it's that we're not going to develop them because we're not capable of it, but we're not there yet and we're not going out fast enough. So how do you create those levers? So from your work, kind of looking at this perspective in the field more generally, what traits or events or patterns historically have you seen that we could draw parallels to? How have levers for action on a topic or an issue culturally come about, and how can we mimic that?
Let me say I don't know. I mean, that's just, I'm not a detailed historian of culture, and or of political institutions or of ethical ideas and so on. But if you're saying that looking at what has been done, what is now being done and has been done in the past, and thinking about similarities and differences and trying to draw morals would be a really useful thing to do, I say yes. Yes, it absolutely would. I mean, I couldn't undertake to do it, I'm not a historian, but yes, I'm sure there are inspiring models and I would say also that we need to be inventive. One thing that is present in the debate on climate change is so some people said that the dealing with the CFCs and so on would provide a model, and for quite a number of years it was sort of rolled out in the literature as a model which we should follow. But some more recent discussions say, well, actually it isn't. It's sort of very interesting and different in rather important ways. So it is. So it isn't a terribly helpful model. We need to. So I mean, one doesn't. It's complicated. It's complicated. And we need to get into the detail of it, and having good people, social psychologists, political theorists, historians, and so on, thinking about these things, that would be grand, really helpful.
Okay, a person fell along the road with the yellow notebook, yes.
Do you think that part of the difficulty for us in developing ways of thinking about climate change that will result in positive outcomes is we don't start from a neutral position? The things that are changing the climate, the things that we are doing, are things that we actually experience as beneficial to our lives. And so what you're trying to deal with is how people deal with loss. And immediately, if we've got to reduce the population, that may mean I can't have a child. If it means I have to reduce my carbon footprint, well, that holiday is out. So what you're asking people to deal with is specifically personal loss. And at the moment it seems also that the hotbed, so to speak, of denial is the freest market economy on earth. And in a world in which one's fear is that the other fellow will get the advantage, how to make large political effect with democratic institutions seems to me, just as previously, extremely difficult, because those market economies are actually run on an acute sense of advantage, gain, and loss.
I acknowledge a great deal of force in what you say. I mean, absolutely resonating. It seems to me that sometimes the climate change movement, the movement of activists who might do something about it and so on, ties up the ties the solution to the problem with some kind of moral transformation. And because moral transformation would be nice, and since Buddha and Douglas could do before, so or the Ten Commandments and so on, it's been pointed out to us that accumulation of goods is not actually the deepest source of satisfaction in life, and so on. But the fact is that we're competitive animals, and so moral transformation is remarkably difficult. We've been at it for several thousand years and we haven't got there. So, but it's not at all clear, so, to me, that a low-carbon economy couldn't be just as fun and glitzy and competitive as a high-carbon economy. So I mean, what's at issue is whether human beings can live a low-carbon life which offers the rich satisfactions of accumulating knowledge and status and getting recognition from other people as being a person of worth and or this kind of thing. And losing grip on my sense, I don't see why a low-carbon economy couldn't have plenty of that. The issue is rather that the idea of getting competitive, establishing my worth, getting my status, is the only way of doing it now is by emitting a lot of carbon. But that's a wholly culturally created fact. So if we were, something else we could think about perhaps, that if we could provide a really detailed vision of a different way of living, where there was plenty of fun, plenty of human richness, plenty of enterprise, competition, gossip, all those kinds of things, but with low carbon, if we could provide a detailed picture of it, people might be less unwilling. I mean, so it isn't all, you know, lentils, cold water, etc., etc., happy peasants on the farm. That's not the new world. It doesn't have to be that way at all. So, but making that vivid, I think, is quite a difficult thing to do. But what I'm saying is, I'm not convinced that it's a lack of imagination which is preventing us. It's not the insuperable wickedness and selfishness of human nature, which cannot be satisfied any other way than by the high-carbon economy. I mean, the inherent wickedness and competitiveness of human nature can be satisfied in other ways in the low-carbon economy. Come over here and be wicked in a low-carbon way, mate. let's make that vivid.
It'll be a problem if the low-carbon gossip is much less fun than the other.
Oh, well, perhaps, who knows?
Shahar, yes. Yes. I'm keeping a list here, and you're new on the list. Shahar,
right, okay. So, this may not be very kind, but we'll have the same boat, so I feel okay. Is there a bit your answer to this person has been unsatisfactory? Because you have picked out on the relationship between the institutions and the everyday living of us and being like us, which is an observation that is not commonplace and is not at the bedrock of social history and political theory, and I think philosophers of language and of mind have much better grasp on this tool and an ability to attend using this tool. And so we need those kinds of skills in finding out mechanisms to cheat and have a much faster method of designing institutions that will give us the right kind of levers in the language. Mm-hmm. And we don't have the time to let it go through the historical processes of trial and error. And we need to mobilize the philosophers of language to give us the toolkit to do so. If we can. Can we do it?
Can we do it? I would love to think so. Call to philosophy of language out there. step up and do the. I think you're right. I mean, we need some accelerating process, or it would be very good if we had one. I mean, I absolutely agree.
Good.
Thanks.
Hi.
Thanks for the talk, and also the way you're answering the questions, which I think is really optimistic and inspiring. I suppose my question actually is well, maybe not so optimistic. You talked about how our awareness of time has been increasing over time. But has how much we care about the future been increasing over time, or has it been decreasing over time in recent decades or centuries? To give an example, a lot of the city buildings in this city were built maybe 600 years ago. And if anybody at the time had thought about how much effort and cost it was going to take to build them, and what quantifiable returns there might have been, especially if they used some kind of discount rate, they might have decided not to bother. So if it is the case that we care less about the future now than we did in the past, how much is that to do with the dominance of economics in modern thinking?
Gosh, what a nice question.
Economics.
This is just your old humanist professor sort of airing her prejudices and so on. But I mean, here's a way of looking at things, and we had many different kinds of human relations in the old days, as it were, parent and child, and pupil and teacher, and doctor and patient, and also merchant and customer and landlord and tenant, and they all had their different rhythms and values and so on. And now it's all market. And there's a tendency to flatten things into, so education, a tendency to put it in a market context, and similarly with medicine at some extent. And my own sense is there's a loss there, a real loss of many dimensions of value in human life. So there's a flattening. Whether it necessarily means sort of flattening of sort of more difficult to make real to oneself the depth of thought of the future and depth of time, perhaps it does. But again, I want to say something similar to what I said in an earlier question, that if we could make vivid enough the visions of other ways of living, which would be satisfactory, deeply satisfactory, but didn't have the costs that our current way of living has, then if it didn't look all like denial and giving up and loss, there'd be loss of some, of course there'd be loss of some things, but there would be, one would be aware of gain. And if we could make these things vivid, then perhaps it would be possible to make the change. But let me say, I acknowledge the power of these forces of the market and consumerism and the economy. I mean, they're there. That's surely true.
Gentlemen in the front row.
Yes, thank you for your thoughtful talk, Professor Hill. I'd actually like to sound a note of perhaps a bit more optimism than we've been hearing.
Uh-huh.
And economics and market forces were mentioned. Well, by the way, I'm a scientist, and my professional work has been connected with the ozone hole. But I think about other issues. One of them is, what is it? What is this thing with market forces? Well, my take on it is rather to say, well, what Adam Smith originally said was essentially that market forces are a good thing, provided they're exerted within a framework of written and unwritten regulation. I think he said that quite clearly. Some of his present-day disciples have forgotten the regulation part. Now, here's the note of hope. There have been several, so to speak, political, sociological battles between scientific advance on the one hand and denial on the other, very much promoted by short-term business interests. The first was tobacco and lung cancer, and in a way that story is over, and it's a story of how scientific evidence became strong enough to defeat the disinformers funded by short-term business interests. Mm-hmm. The ozone hole, which I'm a problem I was very close to, had exactly the same story. Short-term business interests, which didn't want to stop manufacturing certain chemicals, worked very hard to stop those chemicals being regulated. But as the scientific evidence got stronger and stronger, and by the way, the ozone hole problem is very, very complex. It's not as complex as climate, but it's getting on that way. Mm-hmm. And despite that complexity, and despite the power of the anti-science propaganda that was going on at the time, which I saw at close quarters, we ended up with what I like to call Adam Smith's idea, or in modern language, a symbiosis between regulation and market forces. And the outcome has been very good because it's alleviated to some extent the climate change problem. So my note of hope is that I think the same thing is going to happen with climate, because the scientific evidence is getting immensely strong now. We can now see much more clearly what is simple and clear about the climate problem. What are the uncertainties? It's not that anything is uncertain at all. Climate change is extremely serious. The effects are going to be huge. The uncertainties are purely in how fast they come on, by what stages. And that's now very well understood by a lot of people. And I think we're going to get another symbiosis between regulation and market forces, in which things like fossil fuel divestment will start to have traction, and we'll get onto this low carbon path. So there's my optimism.
Well, let's hope you're right. I mean, I mean, it would be grand. And I'm sure the evidence is building up, and I'm sure there is more. There's much in what you said. So yes.
At this stage, I have three people left on my queue, and we have about 3 minutes left. So let's see how we do. Short questions, if possible, please. You're next up.
Thank you. Well, it's a bit late to try to focus discussion, but I'm reminded of Chesterton, I think, who said, when people stop believing in God, they don't believe in nothing, they believe in anything. But I have learned one thing from the presentation tonight, is that philosophers are the same as economists. If you laid them end to end, you would never reach a conclusion. I've seen lots of social scientists in my long years at Cambridge who have disillusioned by the confines of their own discipline, have turned to philosophy, but I have never had the alarming prospect of a philosopher turning to the real world for guidance. On climate change, we've got thousands of years of evidence, and if the past can't guide us, I don't think a few models, unvalidated, which cannot force the climate tomorrow, next week, or next year, or next 10 years, are likely to help much. I'd be much more interested to hear from...
Sir, I wonder if I could ask you to come to a question. As I said a moment ago, we are very short of time.
What does our speaker think about the definition of certainty, uncertainty, and risk in philosophy?
That's a very good question that I can't answer in a few seconds. But if the issue is, are we certain enough that climate change is happening for it to be worth acting on, the answer is yes. And if there were any models that suggested that it was safe to go putting CO2 in the atmosphere, somebody would have... They would... empirically supported models, they would be out there, because they would be wonderful. Gosh, it would be wonderful, wonderful to know this wasn't happening. Wonderful.
Sure.
I'm going to pass in the interest of time, because I'd like to speak to Jane at another point.
Okay, so in that case, you've got the last questions.
Thank you. I will try and summarize my question in the interest of time as well. Essentially, a large part of what you've been talking about is the kind of personal involvement and the personal feeling of responsibility for these sorts of issues. And I wonder if perhaps some of the conversation in a context like this is maybe a little, not misguided, but one-sided. Because the people who end up being sort of left in the worst possible situations tend to be those people who don't get access to spaces like this. So rural subsistence farmers, people in kind of highly unstable areas in the Middle East, for instance. There's been some analysis as to, you know, the Syrian conflict is being caused by climate change and drought and things like that. And that it is those people who do very much care about these issues. And that perhaps if there was a refocusing, instead of saying what do we have to lose about, you know, our consumerist lifestyle here, you know, with the grand and glorious West, where if there was a refocusing to those people who are most directly affected by it, and of course this has to do with a lot of power relations, we can't deal with that now, but that might prove a useful way of going about it. But that then the issue would come down to kind of looking beyond ethnocentrism and our own biases being in a context like this. I wonder if you had any comments.
I'm again in favour of those concerns with other people, absolutely, and justice, global justice coming into the picture. I'm warmly in favour of that. I wouldn't see that as in conflict with recommending, pointing out to Western consumers that they could live a very enjoyable life. I'd see them as part of the coherent story of how we could address climate change, but I'm not much in sympathy with what I think you're coming from, I think.
Okay, I'm afraid we're out of time. I'm sure this discussion could go on for a long time, and that's a tribute to how thought-provoking James' talk was. But we have to finish now, so please join me in thanking her for her talk.